Welcome to the Aaron Harber Show. My guest today is Dr. Lisa Barrett of Northeastern University. Lisa, thanks for joining me.
Thank you so much for having me on your show.
My pleasure. Well, I want to definitely talk about your award winning work in when it comes to the study of emotion, how emotions are created. You've gotten awards from the National Institute of Health. Your book, How Emotions Are Made, The Secret Life of the Brain. That sounds like a Disney movie title almost. has anyone offered a movie script opportunity?
Not yet, but I'm really hoping.
Okay. Well, you never know. Yeah. And you're a fellow of the American Academy of Arts and Sciences as well. So I'm fascinated by how brain technology, imaging technology in particular, has advanced. Tell me, just in the course of your work, in your career, how that's advanced, and I'd be really interested in your take on the implications of the technology and what you think will be different in like 10 years.
Sure. So when I started my career too many years ago to actually say out loud, there was no brain imaging technology really other than placing electrodes on top of people's heads and measuring the electrical activity from the brain but across the skull, which was called EEG. And it was very imprecise. And so when I graduated with my PhD and started my own lab, we wanted to measure emotion. We'd have to ask people how they feel. We could measure their cardiovascular changes, like their changes in their breathing rate or their blood flow or something about how much they were sweating. And then we'd have to make inferences. Maybe we could measure their facial movements. But the inferences were difficult to make because people aren't always aware of how they're feeling. They're not always focusing on it. And they might be feeling something that just flits by in a moment that they can't kind of grab onto with words. And there is no one-to-one correspondence between the way that people move their faces and the emotions that they're feeling or the changes in their body. There are no physical fingerprints. So when I was actually just an assistant professor, so very early on in my career, brain imaging was launched, really. And what this allowed scientists to do was to observe changes in blood flow in the brain that is related to the firing of neurons. So your brain is made up of neurons and these other sort of helper cells called glial cells, which keep the neurons healthy, and they use oxygen. And there's a way to measure a signal from how much oxygen is being used. It's very complicated physics with hydrogen atoms and magnetic signals and so on, which I won't go into now. But basically, we can get a pretty good estimate of the neural changes as people are experiencing emotion. So brain imaging really lets us peer into the brains of living humans and look at what's happening in their brains as they're experiencing emotion.
So just to follow up on one of the comments you made and which you write about in your book is, I think most of us think that our emotions, we're constantly and consistently displaying our emotions, for example, on our faces. And obviously you've come to a different conclusion. Talk about that.
Well,
and I won't start crying because that's, you know, an obvious emotion potentially or not.
Well, people cry for many reasons, actually. They cry when they're sad. They cry when they're angry. They cry when they're happy. And so actually just observing that someone's crying doesn't really tell you how they're feeling or what kind of a state they're in. I think from my perspective, I didn't really start off studying emotion. That wasn't what I went to graduate school to study. I was really using measures of emotion, so really just asking people how they felt and finding that was tricky because people can't always verbalize how they're feeling. And I thought, well, I'll just measure people's facial movements because everyone knows that, you know, people scowl when they're angry and they smile when they're happy and they pout or frown or cry when they're sad. And this is in every introductory psychology textbook. So, but then I went to the literature, I started reading the published findings, and I realized actually people scowl, you know, about 20% of the time when they're angry. They're not moving their faces randomly when they're angry, but they're doing other things with their faces. So think about when you're angry. You sometimes cry when you're angry. You sometimes sit quietly and plot the demise of your enemies when you're angry. Sometimes you laugh in the face of anger. You do many things when you're angry, and you scowl at times when you're not angry. So my husband, for example, makes a full facial scowl, like the stereotype of an anger expression, when he's concentrating really hard. People scowl when they're curious and they're focusing. When they're confused, they scowl when they have heartburn. And so I thought, okay, the face won't work. I will measure the body. I will measure changes in people's heart rate. So everyone knows that your heart rate goes up when you're afraid and your blood pressure goes up when you're angry. And it turns out that's actually not really true. So sometimes when you're angry, your heart rate goes up. Sometimes it goes down. Sometimes it stays the same. Sometimes your blood pressure goes up. Sometimes it goes down. Sometimes it stays the same. Really, what drives what's related to your physical changes, the physical changes in your body, is the action that you're about to take. And people take many actions in anger or fear or what have you. And so systematically, I just kind of went through measure by measure, trying to figure out how to measure emotion. And then, you know, brain imaging came along, and everyone had this hypothesis that emotions lived in particular parts of the brain. So fear lives in this group of cells in a region called the amygdala, apparently. And so the first thing that I did was I did what's called a meta-analysis, which is to look at all the published studies that have ever been done on emotion and summarize them and see, well, is there evidence that that emotions can be localized to specific parts of the brain? Do we have these circuits in our brains for anger, sad, fear, disgust, and so on that are specifically localized to a set of neurons? That was the hypothesis.
I think there's a Disney movie that proved that theory, by the way.
Yeah, so what's so interesting about Inside Out, it's such a great movie. What I like to tell people, though, is I'm actually a real fan of cartoons. In my house, cartoons are a big fun family thing we do together. You know, chemistry in cartoons, chemists, you know, blow up things with colorful liquids. In Roadrunner cartoons, right, Wile E. Coyote runs off a cliff and doesn't actually fall until he looks down.
And right? Realizes.
Yeah, so we enjoy cartoons about chemistry and physics, understanding that they don't actually teach us anything about chemistry and physics. The unfortunate thing about Inside Out was that Pixar claimed, along with some scientists who were consulting for Pixar, that the movie actually was scientifically accurate. And, you know, what I talk about in my book and in various articles and so on is, you know, the data are what they are. From my reading of the data, that movie was like super entertaining and fun, but not at all accurate from a scientific standpoint, but it doesn't have to be. It's a cartoon, right? You know, Pixar is great at putting emotions into cars, you know, robots, toys, food, and people. And actually, if you actually watch the movie really closely, you can see, for example, Mr. Anger, sometimes he pouts, sometimes he smiles. You know, he does many things. He doesn't just blow his top, although those are really fun moments in the movie. So brain imaging really, in a sense, revolutionized the science of emotion. It didn't teach us anything that we couldn't suspect from other measures, I would say. You know, that anger is not a thing, it's a category of instances that are variable. Right? You don't have one kind of anger that you experience, you have many kinds of anger, and they're different in different situations. And we see this when we measure facial movements, and we see it when we measure the body, and we also see it when we measure the brain. So when you look at what someone's brain is doing when they are emotional, you can see that, you know, the amygdala, for example, increases its firing, its neural activity, certainly when people are afraid, about 30% of the time. So in about 70% of the cases, there is no change in amygdala activity, but yet the person is afraid. And in fact, people who have lesions of the amygdala, where their amygdala neurons are completely destroyed, also experience fear in certain circumstances. And we see an increase in amygdala activity when people are disgusted, when they're happy, when they're angry, when they're sad. We see an increase in amygdala activity when people are just looking at something novel that they've never seen before. Because the task of those amygdala neurons is to signal the rest of the brain when something has occurred that you have not predicted, that's novel, and you don't know, you're not really sure what it is. And it's basically telling the rest of the brain, learn what this is so that you can predict better the next time. And so it's marshaling your attention and it's marshaling your body really to get ready to do something quickly. And so what we've learned from brain imaging is that the idea that emotions are localized to one part, one set of brain regions, and then maybe rationality or thoughts are localized to another is wrong. I mean, there's just, your brain is not at war with itself around, you know, the battlefield is not cognition versus emotion or rationality versus emotion.
All right, well, I'm sure Pixar was disappointed to hear that. We're going to take a quick break. We will be back with Lisa in just a moment.
For information on how to help promote civil and mutually respectful discourse and support expansion of the distribution of our programs, please email info@harbertv.com.
Join me and watch The Aaron Harber Show.
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 I'm Reverend Jesse Jackson. Watch The Aaron Harber Show and keep hope alive.
I'm Aaron Harber, host of The Aaron Harber Show. You can follow the show on Twitter for instant notification of new episodes, live event invitations, outtakes, and behind-the-scenes photos. And tweet us your topic and guest suggestions today.
The Aaron Harber Show may be viewed 24/7 at no charge from any location in the world at harbertv.com.
Welcome back to the show. We are with Dr. Lisa Barrett. So we were talking about brain imaging and your take on the future. So what can we expect to see or learn that we're not seeing, hearing, learning, say, in a decade?
Well, one thing that we can do now is we can peer into the brain with a very, very powerful magnet. So I know everyone thinks about Teslas like their car, you know, that's the name of a car, but actually in our world, a Tesla is the magnitude or the power of a magnet. So when anyone, maybe if your viewers.
We have listeners too.
Listeners, viewers, have ever had an MRI, you know, there's this big kind of circular magnet and they get moved into the bore of the magnet, right? So the
we've all seen Grey's Anatomy.
Right, Grey's Anatomy.
Except an MRI machine is noisy.
It's noisy.
Why?
It's very noisy. Well, because there are very powerful magnetic fields that are being shifted around. And what we have to take pictures of the whole brain. We don't just take a snapshot of the brain. We actually take slices of images. And so we can take slices of images this way, or we can take slices of images this way. And so moving things around actually makes noise. When brain imaging started, we would use a 1 Tesla or a 1.5 Tesla. Most people now use a 3 Tesla. We use a 7 Tesla magnet. So that's an extremely powerful magnet. It creates images of the brain that are almost like X-rays in their precision. So we can now look, for example, into the deep parts of the subcortical regions of the brain and find very, very small groupings of neurons that can't actually be seen even with a 3 Tesla image. So one thing we can do is we can take images of the brain that are much more precise. We can take them faster, which is important because, you know, neurons work much faster than our images can capture, really. The other thing that we can do is we can also simultaneously measure other things. So, for example, PET imaging, where you inject a dye, a radioactive tracer. The radioactive meaning, you know, there's a little bit of chemistry there.
It's an isotope.
It's an isotope. We try to tell people it's not any more dangerous than flying on a plane, we can simultaneously look at not just the blood flow changes related to neural firing, but we can also look at the chemicals that the brain is using to communicate. So when neurons fire, when they send an electrical pulse down the part of the neuron called the axon, that releases little chemicals into a space, and then the next neuron picks up those chemicals, and then it sends a fire, it fires along its axon. We can actually measure.
It's like a little relay race.
It is like a little relay race, and so we can measure which chemicals are being emitted, how well neurons are picking up those chemicals, how efficiently they're doing it. So we can measure those things simultaneously. So we're not just measuring electrical activity, we're also measuring chemical activity, which is actually really important. The newest thing is being able to measure people when they're walking around in their everyday life. So normally when we do, for example, functional magnetic resonance imaging, fMRI, people have to be completely still in the magnet, not moving at all, so that we can take pictures of what their brain is doing. If they move even a little bit, a couple of millimeters, and it's really problematic for us. We have to do all kinds of mathematical transformations to get rid of that noise. But now we have other ways of measuring what's going on in the brain using optical signals, where we can place a cap on people's heads that will do this optical imaging. So it's going to attempt to measure brain activity using optics. And people can just walk around, like they're wearing a cap with like a lot of wires coming out of it. And now there's actually development of MEG, which is it's kind of a magnetic imaging. It's much faster than fMRI, there is in development actually ambulatory brain imaging using MEG magnetics, so that you could see someone walking around with a really kind of complicated looking cool electronic turban, and we'll be able soon to be able to measure people's brain activity as they're out and about in their everyday lives.
So when will we be able to measure it in real time and not as a sequence of snapshots?
Yeah. Well, I mean, we can do something that is
close to that.
Closer to real time right now, but you have to remember that the brain is a three-dimensional organ. And we divide it up into little bits. So instead of using pixels, like for a television set, we use voxels, these three-dimensional cubes. The most precise brain imaging right now is about half a millimeter, voxels that are half a millimeter in volume. And they contain about a million neurons.
Each one.
And neurons, when they fire, I mean, it takes about 100 milliseconds, so a tenth of a second, for information to go from the back of the neurons that are right at the back of your brain to the neurons that are right at the front. So that volley of activity from the back to the front is about 100 milliseconds. It's about, a tenth of a second. And right now, the fastest that we can get a whole brain volume, like a whole picture of your brain, is in about a half a second. So
we have a long way to go.
Yes, but I mean, it's a glass half empty, glass half full kind of thing, because, 20 years ago, we couldn't even peer into the brain, right? And now we can, and we can do it in much faster and with much more precision than we could before. And scientists can use interesting experimental designs to try to overcome the limitations of the spatial and temporal signals.
All right, we're going to take a break. We'll be back with Lisa in just a moment.
For information on how to help promote civil and mutually respectful discourse and support expansion of the distribution of our programs, please email harbertv.com.
I'm Aaron Harber, host of The Aaron Harber Show. I very much would like to hear from you about the program, so please send me an email with your thoughts. You can suggest what topics I should cover, what guests I should invite to be on the show, or even what specific questions you would like me to ask. This is your program, so send your suggestions to Aaron@harbertv.com. I promise to personally read every one, so email me today. And most of all, thanks for watching.
The Aaron Harber Show may be viewed 24/7 at no charge from any location in the world at harbertv.com.
Welcome back to the show. This is part one of our special two-part series on emotion with Dr. Lisa Barrett. So I'm going to get to kind of a basic question. What is emotion, or what are emotions?
You want the traditional view, or do you want the scientific view that we've discovered?
I start with the classical view.
Yeah.
Because I think that's one everyone is familiar with. And then certainly you have, your research has taken us in a very different direction.
So the classical view, which really we can trace all the way back to ancient Greece, to Plato really, is this idea that we are born with circuits for emotion deep inside a very ancient animalistic part of our brain. And that every human on the planet has a circuit for anger, for sadness, for fear, and so on. That some other animals also have these circuits. And that they trigger without any effort or awareness on your part. So something can happen. You could insult me. I could see a snake. You could give me a present. You know, and anything could happen that is a stimulus that triggers one of those circuits, which causes a very characteristic response. So let's say I see a snake. That will trigger fear, which is expressed by a particular facial expression, a particular change in my body. So maybe I freeze, or maybe my heart rate goes up and I prepare to run. And a particular feeling, maybe I feel frightened, or I feel afraid, or I feel nervous. And the idea is that everyone around the world makes the same facial expression, has the same physical change, and that everyone around the world also recognizes these facial expressions as fear. And, you know, there's a little bit of room for variation, so maybe you don't always widen your eyes in fear, maybe you don't always freeze. The assumption is that variation is really caused by something other than the emotion itself. So maybe I'm trying to hide from you how I feel, or maybe I'm trying to regulate how I feel. The idea is that there are these other processes lurking in the brain that can modify how the emotion expresses itself, but that, you know, pretty much there's this, you know, fingerprint, and there's this sameness.
Uniformity.
There's this uniformity. And, you know, I didn't start studying emotion as part of my PhD. That wasn't what I went to graduate school to study. So I came to the scientific literature with no expectations other than what I had read in introductory psychology textbooks. And I was just stunned, actually, at the amount of variability. And also at the time I was training as a therapist, and I was seeing variability in my clients and, you know, just in everyday life. Once you start looking for the variability, you see it all over the place. And I thought, well, that's really interesting. How is it that faces and brains and bodies can vary, you know, instance to instance, fear can look very different, be expressed very differently, but yet a human knows its fear? So how is it that when someone cries and someone freezes and someone faints and someone runs away and someone attacks, how is it that I know that all of those are fear? That's a real puzzle, actually. And so my lab and other labs tried to grapple with this variability and try to figure out, well, how are humans solving this problem? And what is it actually that we share with other animals? And what is going on under the hood inside our own brains when we feel emotional? And the answer we came to is really, it's unintuitive. And frankly, if I weren't a scientist, if I hadn't seen the evidence with my own eyes, I probably wouldn't believe it, because it's just so unexpected. And I should also say it requires synthesizing scientific evidence from many, many, many domains of research, well beyond you know, neuroscience, the neuroscience of emotion. Because in the end, we end up having to really understand something about how a brain works in order to understand how the brain is conjuring emotions.
So talk about, you know, your the outcome of your research and the concept of constructing emotion.
Yeah, so the first thing that we learned is that, well, let me say it a different way. We learned bits and pieces of the puzzle at different times and put it all together. So I would say the first important thing to know about a brain, your brain, is that you don't react to anything. Your brain is predicting all the time. In fact, all brains on this planet are structured so that they predict what's going to happen next, and then they adjust based on the information that they get. So the way that I describe it would be something like this. Imagine that your brain is trapped in a dark, silent box called your skull. And it's receiving information from the world, sights and sounds and smells. Those changes, that information, is the result of some cause, of something that happened. But your brain doesn't have access to the cause. It only has access to the consequence, to the result. So it has to guess at what the causes are, only knowing the effects. In science, we call that a reverse inference problem. You only know the outcome, but you have to guess the cause. And the same thing is true about the body. The brain receives information about changes in the body. So right now, it looks as if you're sitting there quietly, but in fact, inside your body, there is a lot of drama going on with your organs and your systems.
You don't know the half of it.
Right? And your brain only receives the consequences, the sensory inputs from the body, but it doesn't actually know, well, what is causing that ache in your gut? And so it solves this problem.
It was a burrito.
It solves this problem by guessing using past experience. So the brain sort of asks itself, well, what in my past was similar to what is going on right now? Things that are similar to one another, we call them a category or a concept. So your brain is basically using its past experiences to construct a concept or a category to guess at the meaning of these sensory inputs. And the cool thing is that it's doing this in advance of those inputs coming. So it's basically, if we were to freeze time right now, your brain would project itself forward in time to make a guess, to create a category, to make a guess about what's about to happen. What are you about to see, hear, smell, taste, and feel? And then that input then arrives to the brain, and your brain compares them. And it either, the information either confirms those predictions, and then your brain acts and makes the next set of predictions, or you change those predictions. You take in new information, which in psychology we have a very fancy name for that. We call it learning. And so we learn something new, we update the information, and then we make another set of predictions.
All right, well, we're going to take a long break because this is the end of part one of our two-part series with Lisa. So make sure you watch part two so you can learn about how your brain constructs emotions. I'm Aaron Harber. Thanks for watching.
Please contact us. We want to hear from you. And thanks for watching.